Good morning and welcome to our service today. Lovely wet day, and Angela's already had an adventure. Well, we had a wet adventure yesterday. We went to Ampthill Park, and we've not been there for the first time, until the first time yesterday, recommended by some of the fellowship here. So I can see other people joining us slowly this morning. We've got Jill, Margaret and Keith, and Justin and family. So welcome to our service this morning. It's a communion service, so you might want to grab some bread and some wine or some juice so that you've got some for the end of our service after the sermon. We have a variety of things on offer this morning. We've got a children's talk, which Bill is going to be my model child, aren't you, darling?
Yes, I'm going to look forward to it.
So he's got lots of things to try eating. So we'll see how he gets on with that. He's got
blindfolded, of course.
Absolutely. You've got to do it properly, haven't you? Anyway, let's start our service with a word of scripture. It says, come rain or shine, it says, in Psalm 34, verse 1, I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will be continually on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Well, we're going to start by singing, Strength Will Rise as We Wait Upon the Lord. Let's stand and sing, or sit if you want to. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord.
What a wonderful song to start our service. Well, we now have the time when Bill has to put on his blindfold. He's got his favourite climbing bandana from many years ago. And he came to me and he said, "It looks a bit rough, doesn't it?" And I said, "Yes, you do, because I misheard." Anyway, that was in the right mood for a children's talk together. So I bought my bag of goodies. And he just knows he's got a taste test. So he has amazing taste. So I'm going to start you off with something that he likes a lot. I'll move this out of the way.
Have you been raiding the kitchen?
Here you are. No. Bought these specially for you, darling.
Ooh.
Tell me what that one is. Quickly.
Kind of fruity, but it's got a nut in. No, not a nut. Chocolate. It's a chocolate covered.
Hurry up, sweet. Lots of them.
Okay.
What is it?
This is frightful. I don't know.
Okay, we'll try something different this time.
Okay.
This one.
Or I can't think of the name of it, which is frightening.
Yeah, I told you it was looking a bit rough. Feeling a bit rough, perhaps. It's quite good at taste normally. What's that one?
Oh, it's in the... we just bought some yesterday in the red packet.
It's got the packet colour. Okay. Do another one.
Slightly sour.
Try another one. When you go to a bowling alley, you see it, darling. There's a clue there. What are they called? Do you try and knock down?
Pins.
They're Skittles.
Skittles. That'll do.
Skittles. Okay.
Skittles.
These are your...
Very nice.
These are your favourite, and they're the ones that I don't like. There you are. You can't possibly get that wrong, huh? Surely.
Oh, M&M peanut.
Hey, you got it. Now this one's a bit of a trick because I've cut it up because I thought you'd be really good and I wanted to try and fool you, but you're not doing so well as well.
No, I'm doing frightfully poor.
Come on then. What's that?
A jelly fruit or something like that.
Okay, yes. He's pretty much there. That was a fruit pastel. Other sweets are available, of course.
Like a raspberry flavoured, I think.
Blackcurrant, but you were close.
Oh.
Okay.
Oh, dear.
This one, I'm expecting you to get this wrong, so try this one. It doesn't come in a sweet wrapper.
Ah, that's one of nature's sweet. Currant, raisin, or something like that.
Nope.
Oh.
That was a golden berry that I put in the porridge.
All right, close enough.
Okay. This one was the last one. I'm gonna take the bag out of the way.
Ah, that's a currant or a raisin or something like that.
That is a sultana.
Okay,
so you take your blindfold off without messing with you. Okay, so what was the point of that?
Oh, good point.
Okay, if I'd just given them to you,
yeah,
would you have stood any more chance of getting it right?
No.
No.
Well, I would have. No, probably not. Probably not. So one could say you prompted me.
Okay, and when I said to you, you might find it in a bowling alley.
Yes.
You knew what you were thinking, but you went American on me, didn't you?
I'm afraid so, yes. There's a problem with that, yes.
So describing it to you didn't really help. You needed to taste it.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Okay, so there's a verse in the same psalm that we started our service with, and it says, in Psalm 34, verse 8, it says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man or woman who takes refuge in him." And there's a good verse for us to learn. Taste and see that the Lord is good. blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. So Angela, when you were out at Shocock Springs this morning, a word to the Lord, taking refuge in him, would have strengthened your spirits, I'm sure, and if not, the sun would have come out. Just now, Bill said to me before the service, and we were praying, he said, thank you, Lord, for the sun, that it reminds us that you're there. And just then, the sun came out and flooded through the window. So, you know, the Lord does listen to our prayers and encourage us. I'm not promising sunshine all the time because we need both rain and sun to get on. So the next bit of our service, we're going to have Angela, and she is going to do a reading from Psalm 24.
Good morning. The reading this morning is from Psalm 24, verses 1 to 6. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart. Who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by what is false. He will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God his Saviour. Such is the generation of those who seek him. Who seek your face, O God of Jacob.
So when we seek God's face, he is there and he is with us. We have a reading of the Beatitudes, which is by John Suchet, a wonderful Christian man, who, as he sought God's face when he was away from home through the Bible, found him and has since recorded every book of the Bible and made it available. So here is John Suchet reading to us.
Matthew chapter 5. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. He said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God."
Today's sermon on the Beatitudes comes from Matthew 5, verse 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. But what does being pure in heart mean in practice? I wonder what you think. In order to help us think a bit more clearly about this, I'm going to show you a film clip of Grease, the movie.
Attention, seniors.
This is Rondell.
Hey, so what'd you do all summer, Danny? Huh?
What did you do this summer, Sandy?
Oh, I spent most of it at the beach.
Oh, I just love the first day of school, don't you?
Come on. You don't want to hear all the horny details.
Are you kidding me?
All right, I'll tell you. Sandy!
Danny?
You enjoyed that. The point I want to make from that film clip is that neither Sandy nor Danny at the beginning of the film were entirely truthful. You could argue that perhaps Danny was the most untruthful because he was pretending all sorts of things had happened in his summer relationship with Sandy when he was talking to his mates. Sandy, on the other hand, appeared to be perfect, but underneath the surface of her dress sense and her behaviour was a different character waiting to get out, as we found out as the film went on. By the end of that film, both characters had declared their love by changing places. Danny dressed demurely and pretended to be very, very smooth and well-behaved, whereas Sandy was vamping it up with a completely new look and acceptance of her desire for Danny. Their lives on the outside did not match their lives on the inside, their hearts and their minds. Although we are left hopeful that things will be different in the future as they realise what each other has done. They have a desire to please each other and compromise and be honest from there on, we're left to believe. It's a simple analogy, of course, of how most of us are in everyday life. One of the most difficult things to come to terms with as you train as a minister is the gap between what people expect of you and what you're able to offer them. People generally expect their ministers to be pure in heart. Preaching a sermon each week, you try your best to examine your conscience, and every week you fall a great deal short of what God is asking of you and what you ask of others. I want you to now look at a picture and see what these people have in common. Well, that was a picture of people from Spurgeon's College that I know and love. Not even the college principal, Philip McCormack, in the middle of the top row, would claim to be pure in heart. I know for a fact he isn't. I've spent time with him. Even more so, he knows for a fact that I'm not pure in heart either, and neither are any of his students. He's taught us and lived alongside us on the days when we're able to stay in the halls of residence. Each day at Spurgeon's, staff and students stop what they're doing at 10:30 a.m. and enter the chapel. Even in lockdown, we're expected to log in as virtual students to the chapel. I must say that sometimes it's a great interruption to your thoughts and activity during the day. But what we do is to remind ourselves how great God is and how much we need him to help us to be pure in heart. We study the Bible, worship together, and listen to someone explaining the latest passage of scripture in a sermon designed to help encourage us to live out our lives in purity of heart. On a good day, with the wind of the Spirit in our sails, we begin to approximate having a pure heart. It's a very rough approximation, but we glimpse the kingdom of God and see him a little. What is being pure in heart? It's a personal integrity, a moral compass. It's being whole, complete, and undivided in our attention and our motives. No separation between our personal and public life, or belief and practice. It's the exact opposite to hypocrisy. It's not doing something right with the wrong motives. All of those things are about being honest and consistent. In summary, it means doing the right thing in the right place, at the right time, in the right way, and with the right people. Commentators universally agree that this is what Jesus meant when he said pure in heart. There's no double-mindedness or double standards. We're integrated whole people that are consistent with the added dimension of living solely for the glory of God. That comes from Donaldson's book, Living Differently to Make a Difference, about the Beatitudes. It's a desire to please God above all else. Well, when I think about that, I think about Job in the Bible at the beginning. God says of him, "Have you considered my servant Job? There's no one on earth like him. He's blameless, he's upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." Well, of course, what happened next was that Satan was said to come along. And he says, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You've blessed the work of his hands. But if you stretch out your hand and take that away, he will surely curse you to your face. So God decides to put all this within the hands of the evil one. And so lots of bad things start to afflict Job. He lost his farm animals to robbers who invaded his land. And he did that not just in one go to get the pain over and done with soon and quick. He first lost his oxen and his donkeys. And then just as Job was thinking, well, at least I've got my sheep, he heard that these were all killed in a bushfire. All the servants looking after the animals, except one, in both circumstances, were lost. And then, just as he was beginning to think, well, at least I got my family, they died as the house of his oldest son collapsed upon all of them when they were having a party. Job at this point sinks to his knees, tears his robes, and follows the normal pattern of expressing grief and mourning in his culture and in his time. As he does this, he begins to pray, reminding himself that God is in charge and that he began his life with nothing, and it was God who gave him all he had owned and his children. And so he decides to try and bring thanks to God instead of bitterness. The point is, we often try to understand our lives, try to bring questions of cause and effect to what is happening or has happened. And in times like this, we can struggle to make sense of anything. Sometimes the most godly people, like Job, suffer all kinds of indignities and evil. My American mother-in-law has a habit of saying, God doesn't teach us that everything in life will be a rose garden. He simply promises he will be with us as we face things. It's such a challenge to our pure-heartedness, our faith, isn't it? If any of us are really honest, we have parts of our lives that leave us in puzzlement. It's too complicated to create some sort of story telling us that God created it all for our good. We're left with our answers. The story of Job is helpful because it teaches us that God understands what loss and sorrow is when it involves family, livelihood, and maintaining our faith. Job and his friends struggled to understand things and sometimes were tempted to blame God or at least question his intentions. God understands and he is with us. At the end of Job, he says, though, who are you to question God? When we look at the state of the world today, we're often led to say, what is going on? I know I am. Some of the most influential people in my faith are people that have been through hard times and managed to stay pure in heart. That doesn't mean they haven't grieved or mourned when they've lost things, but they've managed to stay on track with God. There's a very eminent theologian and pastor who was once a principal at Spurgeon's College. At the pinnacle of his career, with many options open to him, he chose to follow God's calling to be a pastor in a church. He uprooted his wife and his belongings, and he went hundreds of miles away from where he'd been living just to answer the call of God. And it was shortly after that move that he lost his wife unexpectedly as she died. It was a terrible blow to him personally and in his plans for his ministry. Yet he kept going, having trust and faith in God's provision and purpose at that time. I know many of you have stories to tell at Cottenham Baptist Church of tragedy and loss and difficulty. There are many things in life that we don't know the answers to. But the challenge to us all is how we respond amid the crisis and the difficulty. Do we nurse our wounds and allow bitterness and anxiety to sow problems for the remainder of our lives? Or do we acknowledge
there are enormous limitations to our understanding of most things, and trust God anyway, that he has the answer. There's a man I know that's taken his family out of their country to serve in a far-off land, bringing hope to many in the third world through providing radio and internet transmission. This brings news events on Transworld Radio and godly perspective to many in the world who otherwise would not have this. Yet this faithful family lost their youngest child, who was knocked off his bike and killed in a road traffic accident, at a very young age. It was humbling watching their response. They used the famous words in Job, "The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." They, like Job, were devastated. They mourned, but early on, they made the decision that it wouldn't destroy their relationship with God. So what has this got to do with blessed are the pure in heart? Well, staying pure in heart has a lot to do with choice. Whether to follow God, whether to trust him, whether to allow difficult things in your life that you can't explain to drown out the lovely, admirable things that go on as well, that come from God. Whether to think of that which is good, lovely, admirable, pure and noble in any situation, as it says in Philippians 4:8. Do we allow the bad in our minds to drown out the good? Whether you choose to allow things to tempt your heart and your actions off the narrow way of what God has for you. When I was thinking about the movie Grease, it was obvious that what was going on in Sandy and Danny's hearts is a battle of emotions. When you're confronted with someone you love, you want to be like someone that they will want to love in return. One of the reasons that we enjoy the film is because we all struggle to become someone worthy of love. We struggle to be single-minded. Our drive to promote our own way and our own selfishness gets in the way. Well, it's the same with our relationship with God. We have to battle our minds and our hearts in order to try to remain pure in heart. I'm going to show you another film clip, which I will talk briefly about afterwards. It's from the film Black Panther. The point we can take from this clip is that the fight inside ourselves feels like a battle between good and bad. It feels like a battle for survival. Yet the answer is very counterintuitive. We need to take our guard down, become vulnerable, and lay down our protective layers before God. We need to allow him to reach us as we really are, so that his spirit can work in our lives to make us pure in heart. It's only God himself that can change us from within to become pure in heart. We can attend church, read our Bibles and pray fervently, but if we're not prepared to recognise ourselves as we really are, we cannot be changed gradually and patiently by the love of God and his power. We will never become fully pure in heart in this life. Get used to it, as my mother-in-law would say. It's a permanent thing in this world. We will never become pure in heart. But the process is able to start by accepting your limitations, your faults and your imperfect ways, and confessing them, asking for God's Spirit to restore you each day and his help to live with more integrity in our messy world that's trying to tempt us off track. It is in these moments of truly accepting who we are we will be closest to our God. 1 John 4:16 says, "We know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them." We remember then that we are clothed with the righteousness of Jesus, and in this we take courage. But we don't forget that we're faulty human beings who need his help. It is this attitude that stops us from developing a critical spirit, a bitter heart, and double-mindedness about our faith. But in this world of difficulty, where truth and integrity is not always valued, we all need constantly reminding of this. When we worship together, we feel a wonderful sense of God's presence. The Apostle Paul describes this as seeing in a dark glass darkly. Seeing in a glass darkly. He says, "For now we see through a glass darkly," that is in this world, "but then face to face in the next world. Now in this world I know in part, but then in the next world I know even as also I am known." That comes from 1 Corinthians 13, verse 12. It's written at the end of a long description in Paul's letter of what it means to love, one of our favourite passages in the Bible. It comes as an acknowledgement that though we know what it is to love, we recognise that we're not capable of reaching this in our fullest potential, whoever we are. This sense of God is and who he is inspires us to work together as a church to bring the gospel into living action within our fellowship and within our communities. Will Donaldson says about this beatitude, "God's word and God's spirit are the secrets to living and worshipping with integrity. We desperately need both. To be filled with the spirit enables us to be transformed into the likeness of Christ and empowered to live and worship with integrity. Letting the word of Christ dwell in us richly teaches us and trains us in godly living." Well, that's certainly the case for me, and I hope that you pick up your Bibles and read, and you also find hope and encouragement and chastisement in it, so that you can become more pure in spirit, like Jesus, the God who we worship. How amazing it will be when we reach heaven and are genuinely able to see God. It's going to be wonderful to be finally pure in heart, and it's going to be wonderful to be there with everybody else who knows and loves him in worship together. Blessed, happy are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Amen.
And confess you are.
So we bow down. We bow down to the Lord God and confess that we are not perfect. We are not pure in heart. But we thank him that when we are clothed with the blood of Jesus, we become something he can look at and see us as he designed us and not as we really are. So, Lord God, we thank you for that. We thank you for your Spirit changing us day by day. We thank you for the changes we can see in each other, the wonderful things that are good, pure, noble, lovely, and thoroughly you. Lord, we thank you that you send us out into the world and you, through our hands and our feet, bless others. Lord, we pray you'll do that today. Amen. We're going to head off to Fred, who has very kindly recorded some prayers, wonderful prayers for us today.
Our service this morning is on the theme of blessed are the pure in heart, they shall see God. So I think it will be good to start with prayers of confession and recognizing that through the blood of Jesus, God does see us as being pure in heart. So, Lord God, we thank you that the blood of Jesus covers all our sins. We ask, Lord, for your forgiveness for our lack of purity in all that we do and say and think. We ask your forgiveness for all that falls short of what you want us to be. Please, Lord, give us the strength and resolve to follow you and to follow in your ways of love and truth and justice in all that we do. We thank you, Lord, that the blood of Jesus covers our sins and that through him you see us as being pure in heart. We pray, Lord, for our world where there is so much division and disunity. We pray, Lord, that we may have the strength to speak for wisdom and peace. We pray, Lord, for our leaders and for world leaders, that you would purify their hearts. We pray that they too would lead their countries in wisdom and in peace, that they would seek justice and the good of all rather than personal profit and gain. We pray that leaders would look beyond partisan interests to the needs of all. We pray particularly at the moment for the USA and for China, for the deep divisions that we see in the USA and the injustices that we see happening in China at present. We pray, Lord, for all who have power and influence. They would look with kindness and compassion on those who have less, and especially on those who have little and who struggle. You said, Lord, that it is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven. We pray that all may seek you, Lord, and seek to enter your kingdom and to see you in this life and the next. We give thanks, Lord, for the COVID vaccine, and we pray that it will be effective and it may be able to be available to people soon, and that it will save many lives. We pray for the healthcare workers who are caring for the sick and for those suffering from the COVID disease. Please, Lord, give them strength, keep them safe. And lastly, Lord, we give thanks for the safe arrival of little Ava Beatrix and the granddaughter of Rob and Lou. And we pray, Lord, that she may grow well and grow strong, and that she may learn to follow you. We ask all these things in and through the name of our precious Lord Jesus. Amen.
Here is the table of the Lord. We are gathered to his supper, a foretaste of things eternal. Come when you are fearful to be made new in love. Come when you are doubtful to be made strong in faith. Come when you are regretful, to be made whole. Come old and young, there is room for all. The kingdom of God is justice and peace. Let us pursue the things that make for peace. Where lies abound, you call us to speak truth. Where greed takes all, you call us to act justly. Where violence consumes, you call us to live peacefully. And where death mocks us, you call us to live in Christ. We set aside our wisdom, our will, our words. We empty our hearts and bring nothing in our hands. We yearn for the healing, the holding, the accepting, the forgiving, which Christ alone can offer. So may the peace of the Lord rest within us and remain with us today and always. Amen. The tradition which I hand on to you comes from the Lord himself. For on the night of his arrest, Jesus took bread, gave God thanks, and then broke it, saying, "This is my body that is for you." Do this in remembrance of me. For the bread we eat day by day, God be blessed forever. For the bread of this great day that feeds us for new life, God, we thank you forever. Jesus, our true and living bread, touch all our days and fit us for your new day's dawning. God, we bless and praise you forever. Nourish us with bread for this journey, disciples in your way this day and always. Come, Holy Spirit, feed us with your love and renew us with your life. In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, and remember that this was poured out for you and for many. For the wine that makes our hearts glad, God, we thank you. For the wine that seals the covenant of your love within our hearts, Lord, we praise you. Jesus, true and living vine, make our hearts glad and lives safe. God, we thank you. Enliven us with the wine of the kingdom this day and always. Come, Holy Spirit, fill us with your love and renew us with your life. We drink to remember together." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come again in glory. Loving God, we thank you that you have nourished us at this table. We pray for those who hunger and thirst. May they be filled, and we be people who help them. And may we with them feast at the table of your eternal kingdom. This we ask through Jesus Christ, who was and is to come, and who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God for ever and ever. Amen. Jesus said, "As the Father sent me, so I am sending you. Come, Holy Spirit, empower us with your love and inspire us with your life." And so we say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Faithfulness, faithful you are.
God's promises are yes and amen. How faithful God is. He looked down on Job, suffering as he was, and he loved him, and his grace was poured out to him. He is God, and no matter what we go through, have been through, or will go through, God is there, and he loves you, and he is with you through it all. We're going to close our service with the grace, singing it over each other. I pray that as the week goes on this week, you will have a good one. Thank you for joining us, one and all.
Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Spirit be with us. May the grace of Jesus Christ and the Spirit be with you.